the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
And that smell. You know, when I was bringing my kids to church, and after we did it for a while, they fell in love with going to church. And some Sundays I would wake up in the morning and say, oh man, I just need to sleep. And they kept jumping on my bed and says, come on, we gotta go to church. Well, last week, Victoria wanted to go to church, and I chose to let her sleep. And when I got home from church, she was very angry with me. So I said, okay, I'll bring you next week. So this morning I wake her up because I said, well, you have to go to Franklin Square with me and then to Columbiana. So I wake her up this morning. She said, why do we have to wake up so early? But praise God, she's here, and praise God, you are all here. So let's worship our God together. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. The announcements today, Sunday school, can you all hear me?
Pull the microphone closer to your mouth.
Okay. How's that, a little bit better?
Yeah.
Okay. Sunday school at 9:30 a.m. Every Sunday morning, and all are welcome. Choir practice, every Thursday at 6:30. Chef Brad's brunch after worship service today. February 22nd is Ash Wednesday service at 7 p.m. February 24th is the deadline for the newsletter. Please submit to either Eileen or Pastor Cindy. And February 24th is game night at 6:30 p.m. Are there any other announcements this morning?
We will be starting ham dinner again in March on the 14th. So all my helpers, if you're able, I'll be calling you.
There was an announcement left on today. It says, dear friends, First United Methodist Church, thank you for your faithful support to Pathways to Independence. If there's no other announcements, please join me in the opening prayer. Holy Lord, the God that hears our prayers,
you have said that you will be present whenever two or three gather in your name. We welcome your presence and grace in our lives. We ask that you manifest your glory today and shine your light on us. Through your light, may our knowledge of your To the place of meeting.
To the place of mists.
To the place of voices and conversations.
To the place
of listening. Are there any prayer concerns or praises that anybody would like to share? Judy?
Yes. Billy and Vicky, Billy's a girl, that's going through chemotherapy.
Sam?
Maddie Dren had her 24th birthday this week, and she opened her eyes and is responding some to some stimuli.
Praise God. Praise God. Okay, let's get to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come into your house this morning to worship and praise your name for all that you have done for us and what you continue to do for us today and the tomorrows to come. You bring to us new breath for a new day. You bring to us sunshine, and even when the sun does not bring us warmth, you do. You have lifted our hearts when they were found to be heavy with grief, worry, and anxiety. You have helped us to focus on you and the good things that you bring, rather than the circumstances that we have been facing this past week or longer. There are some that may have questions as to why and for how much longer. Settle our hearts so that we may hear your voice that will bring to us the answers. There are those of us that have unsettled hearts and knowing that a change is needed, but are not sure what the change will look like. Bring to us a feeling of peace that only you can bring, so we know to just follow your leading and know that where you lead us will be the perfect place or opportunity. And when the change is finalized, we will be content because we will know it is the path or plan that you have for us. There are those of us that are just not what we used to be. Be with us in our thoughts and help us to accept where we are and know the things you would have us do for you and others so that we feel that we can continue in serving you in a way that continues to make a difference in the lives of others and our own. We lift up to you with Judy Billy, dear Lord, as she prepares for chemotherapy. You know, dear Lord, the plan you have for her. You have put together a medical team, dear Lord, so we ask that you bring to them your wisdom. Allow them to know what you know, see what you see, and allow them, dear Lord, to be your instruments of healing on this side of heaven. Give to her the strength that is needed to get through the therapy, dear Lord. We know that you are bigger than cancer, dear Lord. So we ask you, dear Lord, to remove this from Billy's body. We praise your name, dear Lord, for being with Maddie. We praise your name, dear Lord, for allowing her to open her eyes and allowing her family, dear Lord, to be able to know that healing is taking place. We know that you are the great physician, dear Lord, so we ask that you extend your healing hand upon her, so that she continues to have healing, dear Lord, and soon be able to have conversation, allowing her, dear Lord, to let others know what you have done for her, and
lift to you the family of Bill Taylor. May you come alongside them as they prepare to celebrate his life this side of heaven and give him back to you in their own personal way. Wrap your loving arms around them so that they will feel comforted and have peace, knowing that his suffering is gone, and find the hope that you bring to them and the promise of seeing him again in your presence. We lift to you all those that are unable to join us physically here in church. May you extend your hand to them and allow them to feel your touch in a special way, allowing them to know that they have not been forgotten. I praise your name for the congregation here and their passion to be there for each other, reflecting your love through all they say and do. May we continue to be a beacon of your love to all that cross our paths, giving hope to those that feel that there is none for them. For it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. If you would join with me in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen and amen.
Thank you.
thank you once again for the blessings that you continue to pour upon each and every one of us every single day. I thank you, dear Lord, for the gifts that have been given to those overflowing of blessings. I ask that you bless these gifts, continue to bless the givers, and allow us, dear Lord, to use these gifts in a way that is pleasing to you. So I pray, dear Lord, in Jesus' name, amen.
Please join with me in the prayer of dedication. Creator God of infinite patience, we see you in every plant that grows and blossoms, every creature that runs or flies, in mountains and sunsets, and in every drop of rain that falls. Creation is not something that happened, but something that is happening every day. As we share our lives and Old Testament reading is found this morning in Exodus, the 24th chapter, 12 through the 18th verses. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait there, and I will give you the tables of stone with the law and the commandment which I have written for their instruction." So Moses rose with his servant Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. And he said to the elders, "Tarry here for us until we come to you again. And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a cause, let him go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And on the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the midst of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. And Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. And Moses was on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. Blessing be on the reading.
The gospel reading today comes from Matthew chapter 17, verses 1 through 9. Now after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain by themselves, and he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. Then Peter answered and said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, let us make here 3 tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear him." And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly afraid. But Jesus came and touched them and said, "Arise, and do not be afraid." When they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. Now as they came down from the mountain, Jesus commanded them, saying, "Tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man is risen from the dead." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So the first question this morning is, how many people know what Transfiguration Sunday is? Show of hands. See? There was a couple of people in the last couple of weeks that asked me that they didn't know what that was. And so the scripture that I just read was talking about Jesus being transfigured on the top of the mountain. So that's what we're celebrating here today, is Jesus' transfiguration. So those of you that did not know what it was a couple of weeks ago, don't feel too bad, because I asked Franklin Square too, and none of them raised their hands. After this Sunday, you will always know what Transfiguration Sunday is, because it really is the transfiguration of Jesus. And it's actually one of the greatest stories that I like to tell, because it just reminds me of the mountaintop experiences. How many of you have had mountaintop experiences? Physically and figuratively. They're amazing, aren't they? And when we have those, I would venture to say that we are just like James, Peter, and John, where they had their mountaintop experience. They didn't want to leave it. They wanted to stay there. They wanted to pitch a tent and stay there forever. And I was thinking about mountaintop experiences this week. A couple of them came to mind. And physically, when I visited my brother down in North Carolina, we went one time and climbed Pilot Mountain. If you're driving on the freeway, I think it's 52, you actually can see Pilot Mountain for miles and miles away. My sister-in-law thought it would be a good idea for us to go, and my kids were little at the time. My father was with us, and he was not a healthy man. He was okay, but he wasn't very healthy. We said, okay, we'll go. I will tell you that we were not prepared. It was a very hot day, and it was a very long climb. Going up the mountain, we had to keep stopping and sitting and taking a little bit of a rest. My daughters, they kept on picking up these rocks because they were just beautiful, and handing them to me because they wanted to take them home. And me, I was just like piling them in my shirt as I, you know, made a little pouch and carried these rocks. But the thing is, when we got to the top, there was this cave. It was cool in there. And there was a stream that flowed through it. And it ended up being one of those streams that flow out the side of the mountain, like a waterfall. It was beautiful. And climbing up that mountain for hours that day, seeing that stream and the waterfall and just taking it all in, made it all worth it. And then I was thinking about when we were at the Holy Land and we went to Masada, and you went up the mountain in a cable car, which was rather scary because it was like packed with people, and you just kept going up and up and up and up. But when we got to the top, and we got out of that car, and you took a look over the other side, oh, it was breathtaking. Like, pictures can't even explain it. It was just like the whole world just opened up in front of you. And you could see for miles and miles, and it was just so beautiful. It was worth it. Jesus took Peter, James, and John up this mountain. I know Jesus was prepared, but I'm pretty sure that Peter, James, and John were not. And I'm pretty sure it took them hours to climb up this mountain. And knowing the disciples, I'm pretty sure there was some grumbling going on, like, are we there yet? How much longer do we have to climb? It's so hot. Probably complaining just like we were complaining going up that Pilot Mountain. But when they got to the top, Jesus told them, stay here, stay right here. I'm going to just go up a little further. And he got to the top, and there was a light that shone. And Peter, James, and John saw two other people standing there with him, and they said that it was a Elijah and Moses. They saw Jesus talking to And it talks about the light being so bright. I know I've said this before, but it would make me think about a very sunny, snowy day, like a fresh white snow, and the sun is so bright that you go outside and you can't help but put your sunglasses on or cover your eyes, because that's exactly what the disciples were doing. They could hardly even look at Jesus. He was so bright. And like the scripture told us, they got so excited. They're like, it's good to be here. Jesus, it's good to be here. We want to stay. And as they were talking, the scripture says a cloud had come down over top of them, and a voice came and said, this is my son, of whom I am well pleased. Hear him. That was the transfiguration. They were told that Jesus was God's son. And I think the worst thing of all of this is Jesus told them they had to be quiet about it. They weren't allowed to tell anybody about it. How many of you have had a mountaintop experience and you can't wait to go tell people? Like, you can't bottle it up. It's just going to come out. But Peter, James, and John were told that they can't tell anyone until the Son of Man rose from the dead. And I am pretty sure they had no idea what he was talking about and probably thinking, when is that going to be? How long do we have to keep this to ourselves? In our Old Testament, we're told about Moses that went up to the top of the mountain. And he spoke with God. And God came over top of the mountain in a cloud there. And he gave Moses the commandments to give to us. And I know we're told that when Moses saw God, you can tell by a transfiguration of his face. Like his face shone the glory of God. We, as Christians, need to wear that glory of God. We need to not lose our glow. When we have those mountaintop experiences and our heart is just fluttering and we're feeling the best we've ever felt and we just want to stay there, we know we can't stay there. We have to go back into the world, but we allow the world to take that glow away. Amen? So we need to keep that glow. And how do we do that? We need to find out how God speaks with us, how we become into his presence, how we become able to wear his glory, because people that look at us will know that we just talk to God. We just spent time with him. Last night I went to my home church, Berlin Center. They had Mark Allen Chapman singing. They had a Valentine's dinner. And then Mark Allen Chapman singing, which I am going to have him come here, I believe, during the service soon. So look forward to that, because this man will bring that glow back to you. Because he shone. And when we shine, the people around us start to shine. And how great would it be, everywhere we went, everyone we talked to, everyone we touched, just started to shine, because it's wearing off of us. Amen? So let us be transfigured. Let us find a way to make that glow brighter. So bright that people have a hard time looking at us. Amen? And we do that by coming in the presence of the Lord. please join with me in prayer. Holy One, we come before you, many of us feeling like we have climbed just a part of the mountain, and there is so much more of a climb left to even get to point, to dream that we might be dazzled by what is divine. Our loads are heavy with worry, with regret, with fatigue, with illness, with despair for all in the world that is hurting in danger and bondage and more. We trudge ahead following you, stumbling, hoping, praying, breathing hard, hearts pounding, and yes, even some of us are nimble and skipping. Lead us, Lord, to the top of that mountain where we might be dazzled by your light, lifted by what is divine, and filled by the sheer delight of what is mystical and fragile and grounded and real. We pray this for ourselves, for one another, and for the world in which we live in. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you would join with me now in singing In the Garden, number 314. Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the guidance of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.